Thank you, Dr. Naresh and Mr. Chairpersons. I must congratulate my good friend Vitul for having organized this lovely meet. I think it's the third or fourth time that we are here. And it's a huge effort to, especially on a rainy day, and I must appreciate all of you for having come across from various parts of the state for this meeting. Vitul holds this Webicon very near to his heart and he works virtually for the whole year. So I must say his efforts, all the time that he has devoted has really borne fruit and we have so many people committed. It's a pleasure to be with all of you. The task assigned to me for the next about 20 minutes is the management of hypertension in primary care. Beyond interventions to earn our livelihood, but we, our passion is to treat patients with hypertension because this is the area with which you have maximum impacts in terms of public health. A beautiful paper by Dr. Vikram Patel published in Lancet a couple of years back showed that in terms of how much impact you are going to make in improving the longevity or the quality of life of individuals, high blood pressure ranks the highest. It's higher than blood glucose levels. It fares higher than what you eat. Diet which includes vegetables, tobacco use, cholesterol levels, smoking habits, physical inactivity. So in terms of public impact, in terms of improving longevity of life of individuals, as physicians, it is going to be of paramount importance that you treat patients with hypertension effectively and you control their blood pressure as well. What Dr. Jumani, one of the best lectures I've ever heard actually, my friend, he just told us. He said, we have the wisdom, we have the tools and we should act now. I would say that same thing holds true for hypertension also because we do have various drugs, various non-pharmacological methods in our armamentarium and the sooner we act for these for this problem, the better it will be for our society. We just had a beautiful lecture from Naveen Mittal in terms of how best to treat patients of diabetes. And one of my favorite commenting patients when I go for diabetes meetings is, if you treat diabetes effectively, or if you reach HbA1c levels to a significant level of control, a couple of years back, there are three trials that showed you do not impact mortality to a very large extent. And that's the reason. These people now, the diabetologists are less aggressive in terms of levels that they want to achieve. But in diabetics, if you achieve good blood pressure control, that makes a more significant difference to reduction of their mortality. We live in a country which has a prevalence of about 25%. World over, we know the population of the world is about 6.5 million. 1.2 million of these individuals live in India. And we have a prevalence of about 25% in terms of hypertension prevalence. It's quite variable. In the rural areas, we have a prevalence of about 10-12%. In urban areas, people like you and me, we have a prevalence of 25%. We did a study in Ludhiana amongst manual laborers. The cycle workers, we had a prevalence of 2-3%. And people in PAU, priests and doctors, the prevalence was 32%. So lifestyle impacts to a very large extent as to what percentage of people. We are genetically prone to this disease, but how you live your life makes a huge difference in terms of this. Very simple, rural individuals are genetically like us. They have a prevalence of 10-12%, whereas we urbanites have a prevalence of about 25%. So one in four individuals in any group would have hypertension. There are a huge number of drugs and a lot of pharmaceutical industry. Individuals are interested in this, they come to us with very, very trials and impact or influence our decision making as to how best we should treat our patients. But I would like to draw your attention, trials which are done by the NIH, by non-pharmaceutical funded trials, are the ones which give us the best impressions as to how best we should manage our patients with various diseases. And I cannot but mention this trial at this stage. The ALHAD trial is the largest trial ever to have been conducted. 40,000 individuals were taken in this study. Four agents were used, doxazosin, diuretic, chlorthalidone, lisinopril, US arm was withdrawn. At this time, we were also looking at whether the so-called dual agents, that is the calcium channel blockers or the ACE inhibitors and receptor blockers, whether they are better than the conventional drugs, that is the beta blockers or the diuretics. And there was a lot of feeling amongst physicians that possibly the newer drugs are better than the earlier drugs. We realized from this particular study that diuretics chlorthalidone reduced blood pressure more than a clonopin, more than the sinopril, and these patients had lesser incidence of heart failure, lesser incidence of stroke. And I would say this particular trial rejuvenated the use of diuretics in patients with hypertension. The value of treatment of hypertension has also been shown by this very large trial, Interheart study, which looked at what are the risk factors for causing coronary artery disease. And you would recollect some years back we were looking at, we thought the whole story of CAD is not known. A lot of patients come to us, they say, I don't have diabetes, I'm not hypertensive, I don't smoke, I'm not obese, why do still I have coronary artery disease? My family doesn't have. And at that time it was being taught that maybe there are 200 risk factors for coronary artery disease. But this big study involved 25,000 individuals with MI across the globe, and they found that lipids, of course, are the biggest factor in causation of coronary artery disease. We all know stroke, the biggest risk factor is hypertension, and coronary artery disease, the biggest risk factor is lipids. And for, it is for this reason that hypertension intervention trials which were done in the 90s, they showed more reduction in stroke incidence. They could not show as much reduction in coronary events. But even in this, if you look at lipids, they make an impact in terms of how much risk increase happens with lipids is 3.8 times, with hypertension 2.8, it's even more than diabetes, abdominal obesity, smoking, the diet that you take. So hypertension impacts as the second most important factor in causation of coronary artery disease. So it's a common disease, one-fourth of us are inflicted with this. It impacts in terms of stroke occurrence, coronary artery disease occurrence, renal failure, peripheral vascular disease, aneurysms, and that's the reason we treat patients with hypertension. Now when we treat patients with hypertension, we know a blood pressure of beyond 115 by 70 millimeters of mercury, every 20 millimeters increase in systolic and 10 millimeters increase in diastolic doubles the risk that you have of various complications that I just enumerated. You don't bring back the risk to normal, but the stroke incidence comes down by about 40%, the heart incidence comes down by about 25%, and heart failure, of course, we make a major impact. We reduce heart failure incidence to a larger extent. And that's the reason we want to achieve blood pressures to near ideal levels. And that is the reason we have so many guidelines in the, all across the world. The JMC guidelines were the first ones, and there's a history because these were the first guidelines in terms of management of any disease. Various other disease guidelines came subsequently. In the hierarchy of evidence-based medicine that we today live in, we all know randomized, double-blind randomized trials are the best in terms of giving you results and letting you know what forms of therapy, the impressions that we have, impact mortality. But how to interpret these randomized double-blind trials, and in all scenarios you cannot even do these trials. So case-controlled studies, registries, expert impressions, they are all conglomerated into one set of suggestions which are then put as guidelines, and we in our own country formed the Indian Hypertension Guidelines in 2001. We came up with the second Indian Guidelines in 2007. Now I'll quote from these guidelines in view of our very special geographical, ethnic, climatic, dietary, literacy and socioeconomic variables. The guidelines for Indians as to how best we should treat our patients would obviously be different from how the Western society thinks. The aim of these guidelines is just to give you an idea as to how best you should treat your patients. These are not hard, fast rules by which you are bound as to how you should treat your patient. These only are suggestions as to what the evidence-based medicine today is saying in terms of how we would like you to treat your patients. The classification of hypertension is very simple. We have optimal blood pressures of less than 120 by 80. Why we have categorized three categories within the normal range? Because we want to give an impression to by the JMC guidelines. The Indian guidelines rejected this term because we know almost 50% of the population would fall into a category of pre-hypertension. And it's going to make a lot of fear and lot of public outcry is going to be there. So we rejected this term, and today world over high normal blood pressure is 130 by 140 systolic and 85 by 90 diastolic. These are individuals who are at a somewhat higher risk than normal individuals. They might move on to stages, subsequent stages of hypertension, stage 1, 2, 3. This is in the Indian guidelines. The JNC guidelines have only stage 1 and 2, whereas we have this 320 millimeters increase in systolic and 10 millimeters increase in diastolic would push your patient from stage 1, 2, 2 3. Isolated systolic hypertension, we know happens in elderly. It is more difficult to treat. Earlier we used to believe that it does not increase the risk as much, but today we know systolic hypertension increases the risk of various end organ damage to a larger extent than the diastolic hypertension also. I just touched upon a couple of aspects because it's very difficult for me to cover hypertension as such. This is one aspect which I thought I would like to share with you. Now, blood pressure apparatuses that we use today in our country are still Mercury sphygmomanometers. I know the Mercury sphygmomanometer is very dear to us because this was invented 100 years back, and this is the first device that you and I, first procedure I would say, that we learned as medical students. And we learned it with the Mercury sphygmomanometer, and so we feel that it is the best thing that we have in our armamentarium. But the world is shifting, the world is moving. People have realized that mercury is a healthcare hazard. And the largest amount of mercury is present in the sphygmomanometer, 80 to 100 grams. The thermometers contain almost one-tenth the mercury. We agree it's the gold standard. We've used it for a long period of time. All target organ damage studies have been done with this. There is not too much of variation. But friends, for these various issues of accuracy which people have realized of late, but more importantly, the ecological factors, the health hazards of mercury have been realized world over. Also, second important factor is alternative devices are today available. The amyloid sphygmomanometer, the electronic sphygmomanometers are today available. Many years back, we did not have as much faith in these devices. We today have more faith. And another very significant development that has occurred in terms of how we look at our patients of hypertension is home monitoring. Couple of years back, we used to practice and also preach that blood pressures that are recorded at home by patients are not to be relied upon. I would say diabetologists were faster than us. They started depending upon home blood sugar to a larger extent. But today, world over, since the Canadian guidelines which came 5 years back, it's been realized that if you make patients responsible, the home blood pressures reflect to a larger extent the subsequent occurrence of complications as compared to the office recordings that you and I take because of the white coat effect and so many other factors. So home blood pressure recording is to be dependent upon. These alternative devices are good enough, and mercury we know is a neurotoxin. All things came to light from the Mad Hatters of the 19th century when mercury poisoning occurred at the famous Minamata tragedy of Japan. It also happened in the Kodai Canal, the thermometer factory of South. And so people realized that mercury has to be weighed off from our instruments that we use for recording. I just quote Iodine way back in 2003 said demise of the mercury sphygmomanometer and dawning of a new era in blood pressure measurement. So this is that the Scandinavian countries were the first ones to adopt the aneroid and the electronic sphygmomanometer as compared to the rest of the world, and it's been for the last 15 years that they do not have used Mercury sphygmometers. The WHO and the healthcare without harm took it upon itself. They said achieve virtual elimination of Mercury based thermometers and BP apparatuses over the next decade. Their target is by 2070 to phase out the use of Mercury containing thermometers. The Delhi government has been active in this, and most tertiary hospitals in Delhi and also the NIH does not recommend any mercury thermometers to be used in NIH accredited hospitals. Our own hospital has dispensed with the friends. And with due precautions of frequent calibrations, we also need to move in this direction. The mercury sphygmomanometer might become non-available over a period of time. So I urge everyone to change from mercury to the aneuroid or electronic blood pressure effects. The second important aspect I want to share with you is, now the home blood pressure monitoring, now this is the NICE guidelines, the British Hypertension, the NICE National Institute of Clinical Excellence in Britain gives guidelines for the GPs. Just as the AHA/ACT guidelines the Americans have, the NICE guidelines are followed by the GPs all across. Now the British guidelines are always more simplistic than the American guidelines, and since they are meant for the GPs. Now for the GPs, what they say is stage 1 hypertension is clinic blood pressure more than 140/90, ambulatory blood pressure or home blood pressure more than 135/95. So this has come into the ambit of classification of hypertension also. Depend upon home blood pressures, ask your patients to record home blood pressure, look at it. Normally the home blood pressure is 5 to 10 millimeters mercury less than the hospital or the office blood pressure recording. It has also been put into staging, so you can stage hypertension accordingly. Now, I'll just say in the second Indian hypertension guidelines, I'll quote how our thinking's changed. We wrote at this time, and I'm not ashamed of this because I was part of the first, second, and the third guidelines also. We said in our country, considering the socio-economic and educational level, this method has limitations and may not be generally advocated. This was the thinking at that time. Today, we recommend world over that home blood pressures are to be dependent upon and we should use this. Even the ESC guidelines use similar. I'll just touch upon some of the aspects of treatment of hypertension. We all know lifestyle modification is very important. You have to reduce their salt, reduce their alcohol intake, reduce some of the drugs like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, nasal decongestants, ask them to exercise, the DASH diet, diet which is low in fat. Some of these things they have to adapt. Couple of years back, we used to say that patients with hypertension should not do weight training. They should avoid going to the gyms. But the newer guidelines show that as you age, your muscle blood flow decreases. And unless you build your muscle balance, the muscle blood flow decreases, and that is one of the factors for occurrence of metabolic syndrome X. So you should exercise, and now this is from the Canadian guidelines, but even other parts of the world, I just quote, the use of resistance or weight training exercise does not adversely influence blood pressure. So people with blood pressure can do muscle building exercises. Something I would say 10 years back, I would just say never do this because it raises your blood pressure. So don't use bull workers, don't use weight training, do aerobics. But now there is some shift that we have. As far as non-pharmacological therapy, Indian guidelines, it's now, if you look at these guidelines, you'll find a lot of recommendations pertaining to our own population. We recommend avoidance of salt processed foods, salt containing foods such as pickles, papad, chips, chutneys. Now these are ingredients in our Indian diet and these have been put in the Indian guidelines because these are the things which you will interact with your patients and you will find. Now, five group of drugs are put as first-line agents for treatment of hypertension. It's not kind of very, the step care method is no longer there. You have freedom to choose any of these five group of drugs. You have diuretics, you have beta blockers, you have calcium channel blockers, you have ACE inhibitors, you have receptor blockers. We realized from the All-Hands study that I said, larger reduction in blood pressure produces larger reduction in risk. Sometimes, some years back, you used to say, if this patient used this drug, this patient used this drug, and usually bother physicians. But for a primary care physician, I would say even for a tertiary care physician, it's the level of reduction of blood pressure. It just boils down to that. How much impact you are going to make in terms of reduction of target organ damage depends upon, you need to bring down the figures. And you need to look at the totality of the individual. You need to manage their diabetes well, you need to manage their lipids well, and you need to bring their pressures low. Patients who have hypertension, they have higher prevalence of diabetes, they are more often obese, they have higher prevalence of dyslipidemia. So why we treat hypertension is we want to bring down the overall risk. So it's not just the pressure, but in terms of pressure, it's the level that you bring down. Don't be so much drug-centric as this drug is better or this is worse or this. Depending upon which drug suits your patient, which drug to a patient of migraine, you might still use the beta blocker. Patient of asthma, you might recommend use of a calcium channel blocker. So it all depends on what associated disease your patient has. Now friends, trials describe population averages. You have to individualize the care of your patients. In our country, I would say, because of great seasonal variation, some of this work we have done in our own institution also, we have to down-regulate the therapy in summers and we have to up-regulate in winters. We live in a part of the equator where maximum fluctuations of temperature happen, so you need to change your blood pressure medicines. This is one fourth aspect which I thought I'd share with you. Beta blockers, there has been a rise and fall story. When we were taught in our MBBS, we used to be taught beta blockers are the best drugs for hypertension. They were introduced in the 70s, they used to be the first line agents in the 80s and 90s. The JLC 7 guidelines in 2003 said they are the first line agents for hypertension. And I would say in the last 10 years, what has happened is beta blockers have gone up in terms of agents for heart failure, agents for coronary artery disease, agents for post-MI patients. We say all patients with heart failure, whether it is stage 1, 2, 3, 4, they should be on beta blockers. All people with coronary artery disease should be on beta blockers. So as far as their reputation or their level of benefit in CAD, heart failure, they have gone up. But in hypertension, we today realize we have better agents and their ranking as agents for treatment of hypertension has gone down, primarily because we realize they do not reduce the central blood pressure, which is a marker of upper is the central blood pressure which affects your targets, whether it's the kidneys, the brain or the heart. And beta blockers do not impact central blood pressure to the same extent as some of the other agents. So just as many other things, beta blockers today, we have to change our mindset. One of the most commonly drug we used to use was tenofovir. I don't even know whether it's available today or not, but that was the agent we used. And we also know never combine beta blockers with diuretics because it's a very bad combination in terms of causing new onset diabetes. So some of these agents, earlier agents have given way to the newer ones. I just quote from the ESC guidelines to give you an idea. Even beta blockers which are treated badly by several other non-European countries have a role. So that's the kind of people are trying to struggle that they still have some role, leave aside whether they are first line agents or not. This is the most important part of my talk, the slide I would say. It shows that people who are less than 55 and people who are more than 55, younger and older. Younger people use A or B. A is ACE inhibitor or receptor blocker. B is beta blocker, we put it in bracket because we don't recommend you to use in all your patients. Primarily use ACE inhibitors or receptor blockers if you have younger individuals. Older people more than 55 years use C or D, calcium channel blocker, C, diuretics, D. As a second step, it is best to combine one agent from A and one agent from the other side. So you can combine an ACE inhibitor or a receptor blocker with a calcium channel blocker or a diuretic. And subsequently, you can use beta blocker and alpha blocker as subsequent. Now, I just brought this slide to show you. This is the NICE guideline, the British guidelines. Now, what they have done is they have eliminated B altogether because they give guidelines for GPs and they don't want to complicate GPs. If you have a patient less than 55, use ACE inhibitor or receptor blocker. If you have a patient more than 55, use calcium channel blocker, use amlodipine. So either angiotensin receptor blocker, ACE inhibitor or a calcium channel. As a step 2, you combine A with C. Diuretics used to be told as the second line. If they are not the first line, always have them as the second line. Now they have been relegated in some of the, I'm not saying these are not Indian guidelines. As a step 3, A, C, D. This is the current world thinking. And then as an add-on, beta blocker. So beta blocker virtually reached the step 4 of treatment of hypertension. I'll just share one or two points again. Go ahead. Yeah. I'll just share couple of more thoughts. We all used to use hydrochlorothiazide, but we today realize that chlorothalidone is a better salt, and that's why a lot of pharmaceutical companies are today coming in our country also with chlorothalidone as a combination drug. For the reason that it has a longer duration of action and it impacts metabolic syndrome in a better way. So prefer chlorothalidone over hydrochlorothiazide. Diuretics, in the Indian guidelines we have put, they still have a significant role, although I showed you the British guidelines. As a second add-on drug, they must be used. Octogenarians, people more than 80 years, we used to say don't treat because age plus 100 plus age, that's the
spironolactone as an add-on therapy as a third or fourth agent in people who have resistant hypertension. Which are the good combinations? There are a lot of combinations that we today have. I don't want to bother you, but yes, never use ACE inhibitor with a receptor blocker and use one from the low renin group to the high renin group. Young age hypertension is high renin hypertension. Old age hypertension is low renin hypertension. ACE inhibitors, receptor blockers, beta blockers, they impact the high renin hypertension. Whereas it's a volume related hypertension which happens in people more than 60 years. That's why calcium channel blockers and diuretics are more effective. So how low can we go? This is an issue. I'll just touch one or two minutes on this. We had a couple of years back the ACCORD-BP trial. It was a National Heart, Lung, Blood Institute trial. 10,000 individuals. Diabetics were taken and they looked at target blood pressure of 120 as against the target blood pressure of 140. This is an issue which as physicians, you and I always feel, how much should I use? Not many times patients come to us, they say, doctor, I'm not tolerating. You put me on drugs, you wanted to reach the ideal level, I'm not tolerating that. So in those people, you have to tailor, you have to be a little bit kind of moderate in terms of how much reduction, and maybe over a period of time, maintain it at a lower level and then bring it down further. So there, this is where your art of treating hypertension would lie. But yes, I would say overall cardiorenal CVA risk would be best when you reduce blood pressures to less than 140.
Keep a watch on this study. We will hopefully be targeting to lesser blood pressures than what.